This is a charming but lengthy interview with Barbara Kerr and Sherry Cole. It includes a great deal of information about their life work, about the history of developing a solar box cooker. It includes Sherry's 80th birthday and really important information concerning living off the grid.
I'm Dr. Heather Devich, and we are doing some videos for the Montessori International Teacher Training Center, and we are interviewing today two very wonderful women, Sherry Cole and Barbara Kerr, and these women are the innovators for the solar box cooker, which has gone through lots of changes but has gone around the whole world and really has the potential for revolutionizing cooking around the world. Now, Barbara, I understand that you have an MSW and an RN.
Yes, I was a special nurse for 15 years, and then I got an MSW, Master of Social Work, and I worked for 11 years in the emergency room at the county hospital as the social worker. And then became disabled, and we came up here and made this research and development home.
Okay. Now, where we are today, it's a totally sustainable living center that's off the grid as far as water and electricity, any types of utilities. But this is just a fascinating story to me about how this began. How did you two meet each other, Sherry?
We were at a meeting to promote clean air, weren't
That's
we?
Right. Group against smelter pollution. Gasp.
Right. And we decided that we both had the right idea.
This was right after I had moved from the East Coast because the pollution was too bad. And I knew that I wanted to connect in with the activities quickly. So I went to Group Against Smelter Pollution. And first person I met was Sherry. And we really connected, and she followed me home with her husband, and we worked back and forth until he died, and then I bought her house. And that house was the basis for the initial work in solar cooking, because until that time, I was interested in serving humanity, but through the health aspects first, and then through concrete services, shoes, food, home. And if you look at it in a certain perspective, solar cooking is another concrete service. So and it's also a health factor. So my life, in a amusing way, when you look back on it, as a cohesion. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Now, did you understand that both of you were neighbors in Tempe? Did you know that you were neighbors when you first met each other?
No, we didn't. We weren't.
Oh.
I was living in an apartment in Phoenix, and Sherry and her husband caught me gardening in the planters for the big palm trees. And Sherry got the idea that I needed some land, that I should have a garden.
Here she was trying to garden in little window boxes.
And so when Sherry then was on her own, she wanted me to take her house, which was a bigger house, and two houses down, she saw the house she wanted, which was one that needed a lot of renovation, and we worked together to help renovate that and to get me into this lovely house with a big backyard. Mm-hmm. Plenty of space for all kinds of solar stuff, anything I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And so we had a couple of years just working with your house and being neighbors, and then she always walked up and down the alley walking her dogs. And she would hang over my fence and find out what I was doing in the backyard. And she caught me doing some solar stuff and had to come in and find out what it was all about. And what it was about was I was trying to make solar cookers. And it wasn't all that easy, because I had a book that told me things like this should be a 60-degree angle. I could get 60 degrees, but angle from what? And how, where, you know? And I was really pretty much stymied by some of the engineering plans that were the basis for solar cooking at that point. And I heard, I decided, well, I wanted to have a backyard that was fun, recreation. So I needed stress relief because I was in social work, hospital, you know, it's hard and emotionally draining, and I needed to be able to shut that off and get relief. So that's what I did. I would come home and I would be out there and I would do this, that, and the other, and I found this book that says Fun in the Sun. Well, fun I wanted, sun I had. And so I decided I'd build every one of those things. That was when I started realizing that plans don't talk to me. Things talk to me, but plans don't give me a whole lot. But I made those, and Sherry caught me making solar cookers.
So the idea of why you decided to do a box cooker, was it because of the air pollution, or was it focusing totally on the need of women, or?
No, it was fun.
Oh,
I was still playing. I was still playing. And I was thinking that I would build every kind of solar cooker that I could build. A lot of them you can't build. They're made out of electronic stuff and stainless steel stuff and special pans, but there's a certain amount you can do. So I would build all of those that I could find. And I got a one liner that said that there was a solar box that would cook. Well, I kept looking for how they did that. And I never found plans until much, much later. And I found plans, but by that time I had a box and I had a piece of glass that had been left over in your garage. And I put, you know, some insulation in there and some stuff, glass on top, and it cooked. Didn't cook real well. It cooked like 230, but that'll do a lot of stuff. And so from then on, I was playing to increase the temperature by each little increment. And I ended up with, five or six different stoves in our backyard. When we were in the middle of trying to stop the Palo Verde nuclear plant building, we had a petition drive for nuclear safety. If we could get them to build that with all the safety factors that we knew would have to be in there, at least it would be a safe place. It was never built that way. But we had a petition drive for a whole year, and come up to end of June and July, we had to have so many signatures on the petitions, and we got them. And then they said, but you have to check the election district of every signature. So we gathered everybody together and we started checking election districts. And it was real crush because the time was down, and people had come from various places in environmental movements to help. We had maybe 40 people, I think, at one time we were feeding them, because this was before there were vegetarian restaurants. And
what year was
most of them were vegetarian.
What year was that?
This was in 76. And so we said, if you do the work, we will feed you. And I started doing beans and rice and all my cookers, and she started doing fruit compote salads, and put them all on the big table we had there, and we fed them. We fed them day after day after day.
With soul cooking.
Well, one of the ladies said, I want to see how you did that. Because she had been raised on a ranch, and they brought in harvest crews. And she said, there's no way in this house that you could feed that number of people. And if you had tried, you couldn't have lived in it. because it was in the hot summer in Tempe, and it was hot. So she wanted to find out what the stoves were. We took a walk around the backyard, and I was saying, this is this, and this is this, and there we are, and there we are. And in that walk, Sherry and I and Georgia, her name was Georgia, identified that this was really something special, that this was able to go into emergency situations or for because it hadn't cost us anything to do all this cooking, and it had not heated the house, and it was 40 people. I mean, that's a lot of food. So they identified for me that this was something that we needed to tell people about. And from then on, that has been the focus. But Sherry has a lot of office skills and a lot of intuition and knowing what to do. So she has led that whole section. And I've been out there putting one thing together after another and trying to draw it out, trying to write it up. And then she edits and she types, and then we write it again. Oh, it was really scratch and grab for a long time, and it was a very close working relationship.
Well, it's really amazing to me that now solo cooking is part of a nonprofit organization, Solo Cookers International, and they took your, did I understand correctly, they took your original box cooker and took it, say, to Africa and other places in the world, and they've evolved from your original solo box cooker into other kinds of cookers?
To a smaller, easier one to ship.
Okay.
And they're still going strong.
Wow. So this is a huge, yeah. It's an NGO, right? Do they have status with the United Nations?
Oh, yes. They have status with the international NGO group and the United mm-hmm. Nations.
Solar Cookers International.
Solar mm-hmm. Cookers International.
I would like to stop right now.
Okay.
And
so you're saying, like,
well, we had this irrigation canal in back of our house,
which is right across the street from Arizona State University.
Right. Yes. And they were starting to cut down the trees along the irrigation canal, and Barbara, in protest, climbed up one of the trees and made them stop. And I was telephoning everybody saying, stop cutting down the trees.
Barbara's up a tree, huh?
And Barbara was climbing up there, and it worked. They didn't cut down anymore.
Yeah. Well, that was right by my old neighborhood, and my kids used to go play under those trees.
Uh-huh. So this boss, oh, he was so mad. He was furious. And he was going to... So anyway, and somebody from his crew taps him on the shoulder and warns him that this would be rather dangerous. I was to the point where I was pulling my legs up because
I was down there.
Oh, and finally no. He says, how long have you going to stay up there?
I had to get that expression.
So how long were you going to stay up there?
As long as it takes. I don't have to go back to work till Tuesday.
Well, this gives you some sense of the wonderful, the social responsibility and the guts and the stick-to-itiveness that you women
have. And all the fun we had.
And the fun.
But the community that she had, see, she had lived there for many, many years, knew everybody on the street. I got up the tree, she went to the telephone. It wasn't 10 minutes, she had that place just crammed with neighbors. And none of us wanted those trees down.
That's right. Right on.
Yeah. And then one of the neighbors had some kind of an in with the political system, mm-hmm. and we wanted compensation
for your trees.
And what we decided we wanted was a bridge over our irrigation ditch so that you could walk from one side to the other. And they said, yeah, the bridge would never last. They'll tear it down in a week.
It's still there.
That bridge is still there. I was just there last week. It's still there.
It was there. This was in. It was in the mid 70s, mm-hmm. and it's a nice bridge. It's a nice solid but wooden bridge. Right. There hasn't even been a lot of whittling on it.
Yeah.
And Sherry and I went back on the 20-year anniversary and walked that alley. And two students were there, leaning against part of the banister, reading. And I couldn't help. I said, I want to tell you the history of this bridge you're seeing. So we bragged a little bit.
Oh, I love that. Well, I mean, look how many wonderful things you've done that affected lots of people. Even my children, even my daughter who's in medical school, used to do open frog surgery with dead frogs under that bridge, you know? It's like, look at how many people you've affected with your work.
Yeah.
Well, so with your solar cooking, as it's turned out, in the latter part of your life, because I know you were a, in Hawaii you worked as a civil defense?
Yeah, women's air raid defense. Mostly we were just plotting the airplanes that came in through Fort Shafter and so on. Mm-hmm.
And you married a soldier who was in very high rank.
Well, yeah.
What was his rank?
When I met him, he was a lieutenant colonel. Or was he a sergeant? I don't remember.
Yeah, well, lieutenant something. Lieutenant something is what I remember.
No.
And that you danced and square danced and.
Oh yeah, we square danced a lot.
Yeah.
Let's see. Oh, I don't want to go into all that.
Just go.
World War II stuff, but.
But what's really important to me is that before you went into solar cooking, both of you already had such a sense of social commitment and doing things that were socially responsible and going to be helping the world. And that's exactly what you've done with solar cooking, it seems to me. Okay. So the latter part of your life has really been focused on all of these environmental issues.
Right.
I think that focus is a very important thing. I was focused on air pollution control because the air pollution in the East Coast, I couldn't breathe. And I had moved from New York City to Wilmington, and Wilmington I had to move again because it was still too polluted. I came out to Phoenix. 6 weeks after I got here, they had the first and worst inversion that they had had.
Right.
And so I was very much focused on air pollution control. Sherry and I worked for a year or more at the hearings, public hearings for setting the standards for air pollution. Mm-hmm. There were six standards, particles and sulfur dioxide and NOx and so forth.
Okay.
And I was both in the nursing profession and the social profession, social work profession at that time, and so I arranged to represent both of those professional groups at the public hearings. And since they were public health hearings, it worked. Sherry had friends who could get the data, and the research that we could then feed into the papers, and she and I made these papers, and then we got one friend on one side, one friend on the other, and a good glass of water, and I got up and I set up. That was after I went to each of the professional groups and got their okay for these things. So you see, that was almost a year's work together on something that we both felt very strongly about. And so then we got into this year of working against building a nuclear plant upwind from a major valley
area,
which is, of course, still a crazy place to have that. Also, they did discover, some of her research people, that there is an earthquake fault right up there, right where they built it. And so we spent that year working together, this brush working together, feeding them. And at that point identified that solar cooking was an important technology that we new and good.
And it was something that you could, something positive that you could do,
right.
Not just go to meetings and right. protest.
Right. The closest people, we all got together and sat in my living room, and we had lost major, major, just terrible loss, because we were going to have a nuclear plant up in
right.
from Phoenix.
Right.
And we decided right then and there that from then on, no more fights. This fight had been long and hard and draining, and from then on, we would build.
Right.
That was the time we put all our money, too, into a solar business. And that man went broke because he was alcoholic, but the fact was that we made a major turn in our philosophy
right.
at that point, and right. that underlay the focus on solar cookers.
Mm-hmm.
And I think focus has been a great help to me.
Yes.
Because to start that focus in 76, and people say that I am one of the more knowledgeable people on basic solar cooking
yes, yes.
in the world.
Yes, you are.
And that's probably true, but it hadn't happened because I aimed for it. It happens because I won't turn loose of the fact that we have got to have these simple systems in the home. We have to be able to talk to women and say, you can do it, you can do it, do it.
Right.
And just the ongoing time of focus has built itself into something that we didn't really head out to do. We just headed out to tell people about the stove and do something positive.
Well, I think that before we get into the different designs, we need to have very basic principles of how does passive solar work. Now, does active solar, making photovoltaic electricity or turning wheels or making pressure and so forth, pressure is on the edge of passive.
That's high tech.
Yeah, but that's high tech compared to what we wanted. We wanted the very lowest tech, made with the cheapest materials, preferably recycled, capable of being made by a woman who knew how to make dresses, maybe, but had never held a screwdriver. And so that was our target. But the principles, the physical principles, are the same wherever you're using them, whether you're using them in a house or you're using them in a solar cooker. You have here is a black piece of metal and a shiny one. If I had these in the sun and you touched this one, it would be hot. And if you touched this one, it would be warm. Because this is taking the sun. And anytime the sun hits something dark, it makes heat, and it goes to the coldest thing around. Well, the coldest thing right here is this metal. It also, that heat can blow away. So, if you're going to put it in a useful situation like the house, sun comes in the windows, strikes the dark of the floor, and you hold the heat in, or you block the sun so that it won't come in and can't make heat. Depends on which season, what you want. These are useful for kids to touch
mm-hmm.
because it helps you see that there's a difference in where the sun hits. You can do it with clothing. You can do it with a black box, a big black box like some of these 18-inch blocks. You can paint the outside black, and one box would be very hot, and the other box would be pretty comfortable. So there are tools that you can do to get into the sensory
mm-hmm.
education that conveys to children.
Mm-hmm. You know, one
now,
thing that I do at my school is I say, I have two kids, if you have a black shirt, you're standing outside, and a white shirt, who's going to be the hottest? And black absorbs and the white reflects.
Do they touch
they,
that or
oh
do
yeah.
they touch
they do
it
a little
just
song.
Learn?
They do a little song along with it
okay.
and they figure it out themselves.
Okay.
So
we'll
taking solar cooking. This was
is a mock-up of the kind of box. You see, there was the box that was in Sherry's garage and they put the glass on top of and got its cooking temperature. Well, it evolved. And you have to have not just the sun comes in, goes through the glass, it's black. You have to have some way to hold the heat in there. And the glazing, the glass on top, holds it into the box. But then the heat goes out the bottom of the box. So we have a double box inside with a reflector paper foil on it to hold the heat inside. Plus, I don't know if you can see this. This is the inner box. The space around it. And our favorite insulation, being cheap and ubiquitous, is crushed newspaper. It works very well. They've run tests on that. And it's one of your better insulators, crushed newspaper. All right, so you have a box, little box, goes inside the big box, insulation in between, foil on the inside, and you want to not put the bottom on the bottom of the box because that's the coldest thing down there, and your heat will come and go right down into the bottom. So you have some little elevators, and you have a black something. This happens to be something that was made at one point that they made black cookie trays. I don't see them anymore. They're sort of gray and they work fairly well, but the black is best for this. So now we have the sun coming in, going through the glass, hitting the black, makes heat, glass holds it in, insulation holds it in. And in case we want extra sunlight, there's a reflector here that will catch another reflection of sun and throw it into the box. And you can work as many reflectors as you can handle to increase the heat in the spot. And you see some of them that come from all sides to a center spot and it will smoke immediately, start a fire. Well, all we want is 250 to 300. More than that, you're having to fight not to burn your food. So it's a very low requirement for what we want. One reflector will do it. But it has to be so that when you move this reflector, the reflection from the sun will strike the front wall, not out there in the yard. So we have this little device which you set this. So the sun is inside the box on the front wall. This little stick, can you see that? It's got some holes in it and a puff and a pointed stick that goes in the holes. And then there's a tent tightener. That goes down there. And that will hold it stable. And we cooked with these for a long time. And later on, we'll show you the nice one that we got commercially manufactured and that Sherry built in her house on her dining room table for 20 years.
20 years.
Uh-huh. And they are good stoves.
When Sherry came down to my school the first time 15 years ago and she helped us to build one of these, she told us that in order to make sure we're oriented toward the sun correctly, we just had to make sure that the shadow was right along this piece of wood.
That's a very good indicator.
So the orientation is also really important, right?
Yes, it is. In fact, if you're using passive solar, you've got five things that you need to take care of. And orientation is the first one. Mm-hmm. You have to look at the sun in order to use it. Glass or glazing to let the sun go in.
And you can also see the reflection down there right. From the reflector.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mass, whatever mass is in there that's the coldest, that's where the heat's going to go. Mm-hmm. But you want to then insulate it to hold it in. And that's why you're enclosing it like this. If it were a house, you would also want to, or a food dryer, you would also want to think about ventilation to not get it too hot. Orientation, glass, mass, insulation, ventilation. And if you see those components, your passive solar design will take a good, solid track.
Okay.
Now, do we want to go and ask Patty to bring in the big one that Sherry manufactured for these years?
Yeah, let's
at this point?
Yeah, let's
it's just, it's just like this, only a little bit.
Oh, but it's pretty.
Well, let's bring it in. Now, while she's getting it, so I asked you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yep. While she's getting it, may I ask you?
It's in the food dryer.
What do you mean?
The big box that's in the food dryer.
The big box.
Oh, yeah.
So let me see. Did I understand you correctly? You said like you need reflection from the sun. You need absorption from the black. You need to have insulation. And then it all, you have collection because it all collects together. And then what? And then ventilation?
Not for cooking. Mm-hmm. You control the ventilation for cooking. You don't let it flow through. Mm-hmm. But for food drying,
right.
or for house heating and greenhouses, that all of which are in the passive solar category, mm-hmm. then you need to think of ventilation. But the sun doesn't necessarily come from reflection. Mm-hmm. Your best sun comes directly through the glazing.
Right.
The reflection adds to it.
Okay. So that's part of collection, the direct hitting of the sun.
Oh, yes. Okay. That's the most important. And what they have one term for an area here, is from here to here, to here, to here, there's a plane.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the area of acceptance.
Mm.
And that's all you can get from the sun.
Okay.
And you have to think of how much area of acceptance you have. You'll notice on some of these that I'll show you later, there is a tiny little area. And when we get to the big autoclave panel set, it's a huge area of acceptance. And you know by that area from which you're collecting relatively how much power you're going to get in terms of heat.
So if your collection area is bigger, you're going to get a higher temperature on your solar cooker?
Definitely.
But this one is big enough for cooking about
250. Sherry has cooked flat cakes and cookies and nachos and
you can do a roast in there.
You can do a roast. Oh, chicken is good in there.
You
barbecue ribs
something.
Good in there.
Mm.
So this is sufficient for some effective cooking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Do you have a recipe book out?
But we have plans so that people can make something very similar from scrap cardboard.
Now, this is the box cooker that Solar Cooker International first took to Africa.
Right. That's right.
Wow. And
pretty
of course, it was too big.
It was expensive to ship.
But you can cook a lot of things in here.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes. You can cook four pots in there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a humdinger.
That looks like the size of my oven.
Yeah, it is.
It's a regular.
My husband cooks casseroles, chicken, potatoes, carrots, good stuff in his kitchen. Okay, are we ready now, Bella?
Yeah, we're getting it all.
Oh. And it's got the same as this little thing. Reflector, push-pull, glass, insulation. Now there's one more. Solar Cookers International used this one, but for a while Sherry and I lost our senses, and we started making wooden ones. Big, lovely wooden ones.
Big ones.
And they cooked like a son of a gun. This one out in the yard, we'll show you later, that was built in 1980. Today I fired it up, it got 300. And it will go on and on and on and on and on, because all you ever have to do is repaint it or fix a piece of cord or something. It's really a durable cooker. And for a while we sold those for $80 plus shipping. And we advertised.
We sold plans.
Well, we said we were going to sell plans. We took them down. This is two stories. One story is we went to Yuma to a council of governments meeting where they had people desperate because their energy budget had been expended. People did not have money to cook and their utilities were cut off, and people were coming up to tell the council of governments how desperate they were, and we were sitting back there. And eventually we had our turn and we talked about solar cooking, and we took the lady outside to show her some solar cookers that we had brought. And they were cooking. It was a cloudy day. It was a bad day. I was a little concerned. But when we opened it up, the chicken was done, the rice was done. Perfect. And so we told this reporter, we have plans to make some more. And we did. I had a way I wanted to make it so that we could drag the glass off and get into it instead of having to lift anything, because we had a friend who had very bad arthritis and she needed not to lift anything. So we had plans to make her one that would slide, and we did that eventually. But this reporter put it in the newspaper in Yuma that we had plans for solar cookers, which we did not have.
Uh-oh.
And we got 100 and how many?
125
requests for our plans, our non-existent plans. And
let's come up with those.
Not
really
only
fast.
That, neither one of us knew how to draw plans. And we didn't know any friends that knew how to draw plans. We just kept working on it and working on it, and the lady would call us once a week and say, no, we got to have the plans, because they had $125 bills in the newspaper office awaiting our plans. Well, finally she says, I'm going to lose my job if you don't get some plans down here. So we had to call it quits. We knew they were not perfect, but they would make a stove. And we sent it to her. And that got us started on writing the how do you do it yourself.
Wow.
But it certainly took twisting our arms to get us to
do it.
Took her busy, her job.
How many thousand sets of plans for the wooden one would you say we sold?
Thousands and thousands.
Many thousand sets of plans.
Yeah. But what we would do? Uh-huh. Yeah. Now that's been popular.
Uh-huh. Now with the wooden cooker, you devised it so you can have a wooden cooker outside and yet have it open into your kitchen?
That's way on down the history.
Okay.
First, it was just this thing translated into wood.
Wood, okay.
And that we will show later. It's a nice big blue one.
Okay.
It's
up there from the train of thought, but what do you think? I really wanted this picture of the Kerr cooker logo. I love that.
And you see that we had a belly band there that you could pick it up and just carry it like a suitcase.
Mm-hmm. Okay. But in the meantime, Solar Cookers International discovered a way to get something smaller than it could ship.
Yeah, but before.
Yes.
And the first time he bought it, because he's a professor of physical sciences at California State University, wanted to
get to
know microbiology.
Yes.
And he wanted to get familiar with solar, and it was a terrible job. Shipped that over there. But when he got it, he looked at it, and he realized it wasn't a toy. This was a full-size cooker. He put it in his backyard, and he's still cooking with it. He's got a picture of a little two-year-old and a little four-year-old looking in it with his wife. And both of those men have doctorates now. And they have eaten more solar cooked food than they have in their kitchen, because he cooks in it religiously.
Now, do I understand Dr. Metcalf's role with Solar Cookers International, as he has been the scientist who's really backed up with research the value of solar cookers?
Yes, yes.
Yes, he's definitely done that.
For professional publications, a great deal, and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. He has graduate students that he's put on crucial things that they need to know, and they run out the data for it. And then they write up the paper, and they go to places where they can talk at the microbiology meetings. And he's done a real good microbiological job. But he also got together with a friend, Bev Bloom, and they decided that they would make an organization to support what we were doing, because two women over here talking weren't getting very far. And that was true.
Gotta have some solid male research, huh?
Well, that men and women, but we needed an organization. Neither of us were organizers, and neither of us were PR people. And so that was the beginning of Solar Box Cookers International. And Solar Box Cookers International went on for a number of years, and then we got a friend here as an intern who was really ready to have a backpacking solar box cooker. And we tried a lot of ways to put a box that would backpack in it. It's just two boxes. So these things need to go under the tables and
show the next step of development. So,
Is Dr. Metcalf a global expert on solar pasteurization?
Wow, well, we got to get this about the rattling going on here. That's really important.
Rattling.
Okay, the box moving. Okay.
Yeah, we'll put it together. Okay.
Drop it in there. Then. Okay. Oh,
there's a picture.
The really important factor historically was you hooking up with Dr. Metcalf, who really spread the profound uses of solar cookers.
Well, he had a group of health professionals over there, and they incorporated for an NGO in 1987, was it, or 9?
86 or 87.
Yeah, 87. Okay. So they incorporated in order to publicize solar cooking in cardboard boxes. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I take satisfaction in is that I discovered that there were solar boxes before we worked with them. But I discovered that you can do it in cardboard. You can do it in things that are flammable. And the temperatures that you reach with solar cooking do not set the cardboard on fire. And that opened up a whole line of work that women could do. At that point, the recycling bins were just overflowing with cardboard. There was no cardboard compressor that you could sell your compressed cardboard to. It was just all over the place. And so anybody could go get cardboard, anybody could make a solar cooker. And so having identified that cardboard can do a job of cooking was an important step. Well, my friend who wanted to backpack sent me on a search, and I went back through the literature, and I found that this engineer in Lyon, France, Dr. Roger Bernard, had said box cookers are too bulky. He and his wife just needed a little thing. And he drew up a thing like this, but smaller. And you see, this is basically a box. And you cut down to about an inch and a half and fold that out, and you have reflective flap.
These are shoelaces you're on top.
These are shoelaces. And they're in there because we live in the high desert of Arizona where the wind will blow this thing away. I don't think he had that trouble in the old press, but we definitely have to tie it down. So there's a set of reflectors. There's a bottom. There's some supports there to keep the bottom up, and that gives you an air pocket that will insulate the bottom of your fan. And then this will give you a bigger area of acceptance, you see.
Mm.
Now, this is what we need, a baking bag and a black pot.
Okay. So how do you, with your foil, how do you attach this foil to your cardboard?
In order to attach foil to cardboard, I put the size sheet I need and turn it face down on newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
Wet it, pour a little Elmer's glue on there, take a swab of wet paper, and work that glue around. Put the cardboard on it, turn it over, get my rolling pin, roll it on, turn it around, and it comes on relatively smooth.
Yeah.
The small wrinkles do not matter. But in order to use this, we need, thank you very much. In order to use a cooker like this, you see, we don't have glass enclosing our hot spot. So we have a baking bag enclosing our hot spot. And that serves to insulate the pan. It keeps the wind from blowing the heat away. And you put that in the center. And that will do it.
Wow. So now, is this a special heat-resistant baking bag? Are they difficult?
They are
heat-resistant baking bags. It's like a turkey bag you can get at the supermarket. Mm-hmm.
And they have two, Wendell's has two kinds of baking bags now. One is a foil bag, and one is a clear bag. So you particularly need the clear bag.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, if you're thinking of like a third world or a developing economy, how could you get a hold of those bags, and are they reusable?
They're being made certain places. They've, the last I heard, they had started making them in Ethiopia, where they needed some. I know they're made in Nairobi. They're distributed by NGOs in various places. But that is the weak point. They're definitely the weak point of this system. You have to have a glazing bag.
But are we going to go on from here to the next?
Uh-huh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Wind, I said, is the problem. So we put rocks down in here.
Uh-huh.
And if you get them just right, it'll fit back this way. So I take the bottom out and I put rocks down there, too. And the thing will cook in heavy winds.
Wow. So is the bag reusable?
Yes, it's reusable for maybe 2 or 3 months if you're very careful. And then if it starts getting holes in it, you can put a second bag over it, or two holy bags. And you want to slow down that drift of air that was carrying your heat away. Mm-hmm. And so a couple will do it. But there was a friend in Ecuador who could not get baking bags. And so he made a little cage out of wire and some cage out of bamboo and then put the regular plastic over that, and if it doesn't touch the black, it doesn't melt. And so we're exploring that further with the big one of this. So you don't theoretically have to have a baking bag, but you have to keep it from touching the black. So that's Dr. Rogers. I looked at that and I thought that still won't backpack. But it's got some things that we can probably do. So I made up one that sort of did it. By the time I had gotten this far, I knew that we had a better stove in the reflector for the purpose of refugee camps than we had with the box. Not easy, but put a rock under that, and you've got an area of acceptance that you put the black right in here. We can put the black right over here.
That's so
all
simple.
And that is backpackable.
Well, show us again.
It's also able to be kept in a small refugee tent.
Yeah. So what you need are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 squares that are the same size, and you put the foil on and then tape them together.
They don't have to be squares. In fact, that one is too small. But I didn't know that then. You see, what I made this one trying to see how I would help Solar Box Crew International, where I had spent years telling them, don't get involved in parabolics, stay on the simple side, use right. solar boxes, and they were box oriented. Yeah. And I wanted to tell them to use something else. Wow. And I thought we're not likely to easily get
this. You can mail,
right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I thought we wouldn't get the kind of acceptance that we needed if I just sent one over. So right. I made 6. I sent one to every board of directors, and then asked them what they thought. And they had to think about it. They had to use it. They had to think about it. They had to talk about it. And by the time they finished with that, they were ready to send it to their engineers. And the engineers came up with this marvelous design, except for people who are dyslexic or
can't figure left from right.
There we are.
Basically, one flat piece of cardboard with the foil fused on it, and it's the way it's cut and folded that you get this parabolic shape?
It's not parabolic, but it is a focusing shape.
Okay.
And you can see that it's got a pretty good angle of acceptance, mm-hmm. area of acceptance. Mm-hmm. And all of these angles focus on the pot area. And you can stamp them out in large numbers in a cardboard factory. You can stamp them as cardboard, or you can get laminated cardboard. It does not work if you paint it. Mm-hmm. You can't. Silver paint will not do it. It takes foil to get enough reflection. But so this is the Cook-It, and this is one that has been used in refugee camps in Kakuma in Kenya and Aisha in Ethiopia, and they take it into Tanzania, and it's. When you get into the Solar Cooker Review, which is their little newspaper, it's all over the world.
Wow.
And it is, it's saving lives.
Yeah.
There are people, one man came up to our resident engineer at one of the recent demonstrations and was real intense. He says, we've got to have this. There's no wood left in my country.
Yeah.
We have to have yes. solar cooking. And it was so desperate, even by the time Jim told me about it, that you could understand how women are trying. They have to walk a long way to get wood, if there's any wood out there, stuff. And it's dangerous out there. Snakes and rapists, distance, back strain from carrying.
Yeah. You know,
this can save a quarter to a third of the cost of getting wood if you have to buy it. And that's significant because that wood, that money, then can go for food or it can go for education. And when you're living on $2 or $3 a week, it makes a difference. It makes a huge difference. So we're very pleased that Solar Cookers International was able to get volunteer engineers to put this into this shape that is so useful.
You know, and also, as far as like going to collect your wood, then it also causes problems with air pollution from the smoke.
Oh, yes.
It causes problems of deforestation and losing all the root structure in the earth.
That's right.
Then you have erosion.
That's
and then
right.
You have no place to cook food anyway.
That's
I mean, this
right,
is just
but also
so profound.
You have all the children. One of the health problems globally is children who fall in fire.
Mm-hmm.
And they're so far away from health services that they basically don't get health services.
Right.
And there's a lot of mortality in the burns that don't get treated. And this is an excellent pasteurizer. So, we'll get to pasteurization. There's a similar effort that was made by engineers to develop a pasteurization system. We got the stove now.
Engineers said it couldn't be done to begin with, right? It's too simple.
Oh, yes. Yes. When Sherry and I started, they had a solar engineering class at ASU, and every year they went through making a slat face with the four reflectors, and they had to calculate the areas, and they had to calculate the rays, and so forth and so on. They came up with the same stove every year. And at one point, one of the kind students came over, and we were about 5 minutes from the university, and he said, "You ladies are so serious and so intent. We hate to have you wasting your drive like this. And these things will never make it.
They'll never make it."
He showed me in the book that there wasn't enough power to solar cook in boxes. And we were sitting there where I could smell the beans
cooking.
In
the boxes. In
the box, and I knew they were done. And I offered him some, and he didn't have time to taste.
More important things to do.
Well, I don't know whether he actually was humiliated and left, or whether he really didn't see that what we had was actually doing the job.
Yeah.
But that was where solar cookers were at that stage in history. There's a lot of solar cookers out there now, and a lot of different designs. Some of them simple, some of them almost identical, you know. It's a lot of furor out there. But it wasn't then. They were locked up in engineering, stainless steel, metalwork. Okay, this one can go back. And just very briefly, you saw that with
folding it as a problem.
Yeah, well, that could just go under the table.
Yeah.
Now we have a bigger one now. This is the size that we actually recommend and we sell the plans for. So this size for backpacking. It's narrow enough to go down in a backpack, and it's got a good cooking capacity.
Mm. Yes.
And that's the one that's in our sustainable emergency kitchen. Now, we just put that back somewhere. So we've done boxes, we've done fan cookers. And what we haven't done is show the final, not the final, but the two durable systems of solar boxes that we have. The one is the blue box that's out here, and it's got the reflector up, but it's out of focus now, so the temperature probably may be dropping, but you can take a shot of that later. The other one is this one. Now we're back to the slant face, but oh, it's so different. There's no reflector here. The case is made out of recycled pop bottles in an injection mold. And the glazing is also an insulation. It's two layers. This was designed specifically for shipping overseas. to emergency places. And so these will tell us so.
Are you sure? Oh, it's double?
Yeah, it's definitely double.
So the air insulates.
And it also is a pit. You see, it goes down into a pit, which helps it hold the heat. This box will hold and cook two of the standard enamel pots, which come with it. There's a thermometer, which Sherry and I do not think anybody needs. You put it in there and you cook, don't you? And along with this comes a walkie. Don't think you want to open that. Oh, yeah, all right. Now here we are to the water pasteurization indicator. And solar water pasteurization can be done in any of these stoves that I've showed you. This little fella is highly engineered. I mean, it took years to get this simple.
To get a tube of wax? Boy, that took years, huh?
Well, it started out as big as a pencil. Big and thick like a whole grin. And the different kinds of waxes, there's a whole spectrum of waxes. You have to get the one that's the right temperature. And behind that, you have to have the microbiological laboratory testing that says at what temperature everything is immobilized. And it's not just bacteria. It's viruses and rotaviruses and worms and eggs and spores. And they are all inactivated at temperatures about 150. This melts at 170. And the way it works is this wax up here at the top melts. It's put into the water. This is a sinker, and that makes it hold at the bottom. And the air makes it stand up, so it's not laying on the bottom. When this wax will melt and go down to the bottom, your water has been pasteurized. So you pull it out. You don't put your finger in the water. You pull it out. Turn it upside down. You let it cool so it gets hard. Then you turn it upside down and you use it the next time. And let it harden again and you turn it upside down. Hard. Then you turn it upside down and you use it the next time. And let it harden again and you turn it upside down. So it's a lifetime pasteurization indicator. Can also be used in milk. And both of those are the source of tremendous amounts of disease and death around the world.
So that's pretty amazing. So this cooker with that indicator can literally save children from dying from dysentery and other waterborne diseases.
Any of these cookers can do that.
Wow.
They will all work a whopping. This is particularly valuable because it's mass produced. And it's shaped so that they can telescope one into another and send 1,000 to Afghanistan. And they were sold, and Gordon Magni is back. He was talking to Martha Port. He wants 3,000. And they're in the process of trying to raise enough money to get 3,000 for Gordon Magni. Now, Gordon Magni is a man that was into solar cooking before we were. And he was in Afghanistan. He says he's built probably 20 to 22,000 stoves and helped people make them over the years. And this one cooks, and they were heavy. It took two women to move them.
Mm.
This one cooks as well as any that he's ever made.
And I use one all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it weighs 11 pounds.
So. 11 pounds.
11 pounds.
And totally made out of recycled pop bottles.
Yes.
That's pretty amazing.
Well, these little clasps that hold the lid mm-hmm. or stainless steel. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, not without its problems. You know, they're still working on fine-tuning it, but it works.
So would it be difficult to produce these pans that have a, is it a watertight lid?
I don't know about watertight. That's sufficiently tight to cook. Okay. You need a lid on the top of solar pots in order to keep the water from evaporating mm-hmm. and moving away and cooling it. Mm-hmm. So you keep the lid on, and the water that would come off of here would condense under the glass and make water inside, and you did just use this. But
so could you show me with the wapi? So you put the water in.
Put the water in. Would you bring me a black jar, please? And you just put that there. Now,
do you need to put the lid on?
You can see that it's going to, you can't really see, but it's going to float. I've got to have the wax at the top, so that's upside down. There's the wax at the top. It's going to float. We're going to put it in here, and we are going to put the lid on because the water will evaporate and keep the water cool and carry away your BTUs. So you always need a lid. It's more effective and more, it's good to use these because they come with the stove. When you mm-hmm. see these people in Afghanistan, they're getting two pots and a wapi mm-hmm. and a thermometer if right. they want one.
Yes.
But they can do their pasteurization, they can do their cooking. But those of us, thank you, who work with it all the time prefer a lid, a jar. And the jar has a clean spot so that you can see what's in there. And you can hang this wapi down at the bottom and you can see that it's floating. Mm-hmm. And you can also see whether or not the wax has melted.
Is this any kind of special paint?
People are using all kinds of paint. I use barbecue black because it will stay on longer. But even so, there's some flaking off. And I've recently realized if I just go outside and take a handful of dirt and scrub it, that will scar the glass enough that the paint will stick better. Okay. But we started out using tempera paint and Elmer's glue.
And there are no toxic fumes from it getting hot?
No, once it is, the initial heating is done, the propellant is toxic. So you do it outside and you let it dry well. And then I like to put it in the stove and bring it up to temperature and then start to use it after that.
Okay.
But once it's settled, it's safe. And it's also safe to cook in a canning jar, which is sort of nice because here we are at 6,000 feet. Potatoes and carrots and some other stuff cook slowly at those altitudes. And if you can gain just a little bit of pressure, they cook much faster. And since these canning jars are made to release pressure, excess pressure during the time of canning, because they have that rubber ring there, they will release, but they will also build up a certain minor pressure and cook potatoes and carrots and other foods. Beans get incredibly tender.
So I can cook my potato soup in the jar that that I'm going to save it in?
Yes.
Wow.
Not in any jar. You have to have one that has the pressure release.
Well, yeah,
otherwise, yeah. You need a canning jar. I'd be afraid to use a mayonnaise.
That's what I put my potato soup in after I've cooked it, and then I give them to people.
Oh, well.
You don't want the glass to explode, though. You have to have one that has the pressure release through a canning jar.
Yeah, and you don't have to spray this much. We've discovered that if you just spray half of it, you get enough black.
Isn't there a company that makes
dark food? You don't even have to spray it.
Isn't there a company that makes those jars called Kerr?
Yes. It is. And oh, little, I wish I was part of that. Things
would
be easier.
Well, why
not? Now you can see that there's a certain angle here, and this is a standard angle, 45 degrees. No, it's 30 degrees. and it catches the sun during a large part of its rise through the day.
Starting
but in the winter, the sun stays so low that you turn it in the other direction, or if you want to cook a breakfast. The bigger pans will not go in there, but smaller ones will. And sometimes being able to cook at 8:30 or 8 is important. You see, it won't get
that small.
I like to use the stainless steel backpacking set because they're a thin metal. You make them black, thin metal, black with a lid is your ideal pot. And they're small enough to fit in here.
So what time of day would you start cooking with this?
When does your sun come up?
Oh, you could start early in the morning, like 6
very
o'clock?
You could put it out there at 6 o'clock.
How about that? How are you sure that you have it oriented the correct way? You've got to move it all day long so it's facing the sun, right? How do you know that the indicator, you know, like this one, you have a piece of wood in the shadow. How do you know you're oriented correctly toward the sun?
I stand behind it and look at the sun. And it just gets to be pretty automatic that you know
that's
where it
high
is.
High tech.
Oh, it's high tech. It's using your body's senses. And there was a professor at ASU who, was he in physical sciences? I think he was. Who got his whole class of engineers into Arizona, Nevada, Academy of Science. And they had meetings. And he invited me to speak to them because he wanted me to somehow convince them that the sensors, the body sensors, are as functional as the laboratory sensors, and to somehow break them away from being dependent on laboratory equipment. And so I was in there saying that, you know how your cookers are working. The way I tested these early cookers, I had two cans, put a quarter of a cup of rice in each one and a half a cup of water and a glass on top, and I put it one stove, the other stove. The one where the rice raised out of the water first, that was the best cooker. So, we go to that one, try another, you know. And that's a sensory. That's just eyes. You can do it by smell, you can do it by touch, you can do without any equipment. And that's one reason that I don't like to have a thermometer put in there. Because most of the world does not have a thermometer. Most of the world does not have a clock. And so they would not be able to time pasteurization, and they would not be able to cook by temperature. And they don't need to. You just have to know that it's okay. It's okay.
Well, that is really wonderful. We've seen all these different types of solar cookers and understanding the history of where it's come from. Do you foresee even some kind of improvements maybe even made on this one?
They're still working somewhat with the formula of the injection slurry. They take the pot bottles, they grind them down, they process them, and then they inject them. Mm-hmm. And there's a little bit of distortion that goes on with the heat, that things are continuing to cook unless they're grossly mistreated. They cook, but they want not to have any distortion on that collar.
Right.
They have also devised a set of reflectors. And I have them right over there. I could show them to you. But I prefer not to use them because that reflected light damages the collar. Just a little bit too high. By making them out of plastic, they are not only doing environmentally sound recycling, they're also doing weather resistant and fairly durable and easy to deliver and lightweight and a lot of benefits, but it's hard to get plastic that will take above 300. So they really want these to cook at 250 to 275, three at the top, and that's the range they get. The fact that they have been engineered for years is why they get away with not having reflectors. Because, and it's well insulated. The angles are right, the paint is right, the insulation is right.
The insulation is only air.
Yeah, and the glazing is double glazing, and it's clamped down in there with a little bit of a plug. And so it will cook without reflectors. Now, who cares about reflectors? Well, they are an expense. They are a wind catcher. And they also say, I'm here, I'm here, I'm here.
Right.
And anybody can come and say that that would be where the food would be. Mm-hmm. And some places that's important.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right.
So okay. The fact that there's no reflectors is a plus.
Well, this has really been wonderful. You've told us wonderful stories about you personally. You've told us wonderful stories about the development of solar cookers. And I think from this interview that anybody who sees it really knows how incredibly important this work is. And that, I mean, I personally want to thank you with all my heart and soul for the wonderful work that you've done, all the years you put into saving people's lives.
Thank you.